Greetings, and welcome to LGR Oddware, where we're taking a look at hardware and software that is odd, forgotten, and obsolete. And our thing today is definitely all three of those, so that means I have come to the right show. Previously, I've looked at the Covox Speech Thing on Oddware, and if you haven't seen that, maybe you want to go ahead and take a look at that video right there, because that's what that is, and it's very much related to today's bit of strangeness. The sound source, or the Disney sound source, to be more precise. Oh yes, what the frick is this? Well, if you're not aware, you're about to become aware, at least if you continue watching this video. If you don't, you could just go read a Wikipedia article, but it's not going to have nearly as much information, I guarantee it, so you may as well just continue watching. Alright, this is the sound source, as it's called. Now supports Windows. This is actually a second release box of some kind. Originally it was just for DOS, but this one technically supports Windows 3.1 and up, I suppose. Anyway, that's beside the point. What the frick is this thing? Well, like I said, this is the Covox Speech Thing, which I covered previously on Oddware. Or actually, I covered this one. This is a clone version of it. You can actually make these things from just off-the-shelf parts. But yeah, this was the actual Covox branded speech thing here. And this is basically just a parallel port 8-bit digital to analog converter that allows you to play sound effects and music and really whatever else you want to put through here as far as, you know, audio goes through the parallel port on your computer. That way you don't have to have a sound card or anything like that. If you want more information on this, I definitely recommend watching that video because it's going to have more technical stuff. But basically, the Disney sound source is a commercial version of it that was, you know, more so commercial than the Covox was. And it was branded by friggin' Disney of all people, which was a little odd. At least, if you think about it just at first, it's like, really? Disney making computer hardware? That's interesting. It'll make sense, though, once you see what their whole sort of deal was about it. This is for IBMs and compatibles. It is worth noting that this is different than the Covox Speech Thing. As far as the capabilities of it, again, we'll get into that here momentarily. But first, let's take a look at all this wonderful packaging stuff. Open your windows, lols. And hear the sound source. Want to actually hear your Microsoft Windows 3.1 applications? Want to experience the sound of popular MS-DOS entertainment and educational programs? Blah, 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 blah. It does things with sound. Yeah, there's not much more to see on here. So we're not going to see it. All right. What we are going to see, though, is that games that supported it, I mean, there were all kinds. Mostly it was Disney software. In fact, Follow the Reader here is one of them. A lot of educational software was made for you know, the sound source, and I guess maybe vice versa. I don't know. Maybe they made the sound source specifically for this. But anyway, the reason is because these kind of programs here, especially this one, were all about reading to the child and, you know, being educational. I don't know. I guess they just wanted as many people as possible to get it or use it or whatever. So the sound source itself only cost about $40. And, you know, as opposed to like a couple $100 for a sound blaster or something comparable, that's not bad at all. And if you can see, hopefully, on here, it actually says, the sound source is a recommended option. I mean, that's the first thing it recommends as far as sound cards, except it's not a sound card at all. It's a parallel port. Yeah, most of the time, if a program supported the sound source, it didn't even mention it on the box. It mostly was just Disney stuff that mentioned it. You know, programs like Coaster and Stunt Island and whatever else. Of course, all their, you know, Mickey's ABCs and 1-2-3s, all supported, because it's Disney. But it wasn't just Disney. In fact, if you look inside the box, you got this thing here. This is the compatible software list for the sound source. And so, if you can see it on your screen, you probably want to go into the full 720p or whatever. But, yeah, there's Windows titles. Mostly, though, this was just anything with object linking and embedding or OLE could use it because it just, you know, it supported that or whatever through some basic drivers in Windows. Like, why would you need sound in Lotus 1-2-3 or Microsoft Word? I don't freaking know, but you could. Anyway, the MS-DOS titles are what's interesting, though. And really, it's pretty much just Disney stuff. I mean, you got Disney's coaster, of course, like I said. Arachnophobia. Dick Tracy Adventure, Disney Animation Studio, a bunch of other things, but this, it's not just Disney. I've seen some places say it was just Disney software that supported it. No, it's not. You have Battle Chest 4000, some Interplay stuff in here, you know, Bard's Tale Construction Set, Castle Wolfenstein 3D. That's before, I guess, it was actually called Wolfenstein 3D, and they were still saying, oh, it's based on Castle Wolfenstein. A lot of Sierra stuff also supported it. I mean, we have Conquest of the Longbow, Eco Quest, King's Quest 5 and 6, maybe some others, I don't know, Larbo 2. A bunch of games were actually supported by it. And then you also had some stuff from like Broderbund and Knowledge Adventure, Davidson and Associates, and Milliken Software, even one by Capstone in here, I think. But it wasn't the most supported device, but as you can see, there was quite a bit here. I mean, at least more than I could find for, like, the Covox Speech Thing that wasn't, like, the Covox Sound Master or something like that, and because that's not compatible with this. But anyway, that's not all that you got in the box, though. Obviously, you got the device itself, which is this guy right here. And yes, that has a Mickey Mouse head on the actual thing itself. It looks basically exactly the same as the Covox Speech Thing, but as you can see, it has this little guy coming out here instead of an audio cable. It has, I don't know, what appears to be maybe RJ11 or, you know, a phone cord style thing here. Maybe it's a different pinout. Yeah, so what is with that? Because otherwise, it's just the same old parallel pass-through. You know, you plug this part into your computer, and you can plug your printer or whatever other devices in here, and, you know, so you could have sound, but also have your other devices still plugged in. Here's the thing. Basically, what happened was you had this. Now, this is the actual, well, not the actual, but the sound source's audio capability, the output. It's an amplified audio source. Or the sound source, I suppose you could call it. And this is more like, oh, this is a Covox Speech Thing clone, but they called this the sound source. I don't know. It's the source of the sound, but that's the source of the sound. Frick! What this is just a monaural or mono speaker with a slight amplifier in it. And, you had the RJ11 style thing plug in right here. Like this. Oh, yeah. That was a nice plug. And then on the bottom, yeah, you'll see it's actually battery powered. You have a 9-volt battery that plugs in right there. So, this thing is not powered by a wall source or anything. The original Covox Speech Thing was just powered. Well, it wasn't powered at all. I mean, you just plugged it into the parallel port, and that was that, I guess, whatever amperage it had. I mean, there was or voltage. That's all you got. But with this, you actually can output and amplify your sound, which was an advantage over the speech thing, I guess. Really, if you wanted to do that, you could just plug that into an amplified speaker yourself. In fact, that actually makes a little more sense to me, because with this, you have like this guy going on. You can't plug that into anything but this. So if this thing goes bad, you can't use it. But anyway, at least though, if you don't want to use this crappy little speaker, you can use the headphone output right here, and you can adjust the volume with the little knob. Yes. I don't know if you can see it, but there is actually a Mickey Mouse head shape in the speaker itself, too. Or, well, in the plastic surrounding the speaker. They went all out with this Disney crap, didn't they? I mean, that is kind of their thing. I mean, that's who they are, but it's just amusing to me. You got a couple other things inside the box, too. This is just the Windows sound driver as well as some sound effects. I think there's 40 or something of them. Just really basic, like, waves. It could play really anything a Sound Blaster could, for the most part. As far as sound effects go, there were some limitations. As I talked about in the Covox Speech Thing video, it didn't have any onboard DMA, so really it was using CPU power to do whatever it had to do. So there was that kind of limitation there, but anyway. We have, what the frick. Attention, Tandy 1000 computer owners. Yes, you can get the Tandy adapter for the sound source. I don't know why. I guess it's not compatible with the Tandy 1000 RL and the 1000 TL3. Well, whatever, man. I have an RL, so I guess I can't use it with that. I mean, I have others too, but yes, you can also get a 5 1/4 inch high density disc if you don't have 3.5. Wow. Here's a list of the WAV files that come with the diskette that I put over there. So yeah, there's all sorts of random friggin' crap in here. Like, seriously, what are these things? Sound effects. Juicy squish. Screeching tires. Gunshot with echo. Xylophone down the scale. I mean, actually, these could be pretty useful sound effects for using some of my videos sometime. I gotta check these out. Can you believe this? You've got to be kidding. Is this new math or what? Good career move. Bad career move. This is business weird crap. Check with legal on this. I'd like to discuss this in person. Sign here. Why do you need these? Like, seriously, are you going to be putting these in your Word document and it has to talk to you? I just don't understand half of these. The sound effects, those are fun. But really, like, please get back to me about this. Call me if you have any questions. This is so gimmicky, it's ridiculous. Oh, anyway, then you have, let's see, the sound source warranty registration. Whoever had this thing before me didn't register it, I guess, but anyway. Yeah, you could buy these things wherever. I mean, looks like, discount stores, bookstores, record stores, toy stores, computer software stores, wherever they happen to sell it. Actually, kind of famously or infamously, John C. Dvorak was really, really, like, sold on this thing. I mean, he was saying that this was going to be, and I quote, "It will become the new sound standard for the PC, period." No. Not even close. It got maybe a few dozen programs to support it. Yeah, they were pushing this thing, and it was so cheap that, you know, it was actually a pretty decent option if you just wanted to upgrade from the PC speaker and didn't have the money for a sound blaster or even an ad lib. Of course, the ad lib was just music, but still, it could do sound effects. Anyway, and you also get the user guide itself, and this is just user guidey things telling you how to plug it in, which is simple enough, making sure that you don't have anything conflicting with it, the Windows drivers stuff, which is oddly enough like the most complicated part of it, because holy crap, drivers were a pain in Windows 3.1. And yeah, customer support and incompatible computers. Let's see, will not work on the AT&T 6300 Gateway 2000 series, some models. Why a Gold Star GT212? What the frick? I didn't know Gold Star made computers. Leading technology PC partner 486VX, the Tandy 1000, 1000RL, 1000TL3, Tandy Sensation 486. I have one of those. I think that is because on the Zenith 159, but nobody cares. I think that is because that the those use a different kind of parallel. I seem to remember saying that in my own review of the Tandy 1000RL HD. I will have to not look into that because I don't really care enough. Anyway, let's go ahead and take a look at the actual Disney sound source plugged in and working. All you really need to do is you just plug it into your parallel port. Make sure that it is an actual parallel port and not a parallel port on a card, like a PCI or ISA card. It's not going to work like that. I mean, at least I can't get it to work like that, so it has to be on your motherboard or plugged into the port on the motherboard exactly. Because a lot of the times it's just auto-detected by games. You can't just choose it separately. Although in some situations you can. So in order to use it, just make sure that the 9-volt battery is in there. The power is always taking from the battery at all times, so that kind of sucks. Make sure it's plugged in first and then turn your computer on, and you will see the little red light up redly. And that means it's working. Probably. And by that I mean you'll want to test it out first, because yeah, it can be a little iffy, like I said, especially if it's not on a proper parallel port. We're just going to test out some games with it here, and maybe a little bit of mod music, and we're just going to go ahead and start off with the classic Wolfenstein 3D, mainly because I tried to show this in the Covox Speech Thing video and was not able to, because that is actually one of those games that's not compatible with the Speech Thing, but is with the Disney sound source. And as you can see, it detected it. You can select it in the options menu, and you'll hear the sound effects from the game, or at least most of them, play through the sound source's sound source. Now, if you want music or some of the other sound effects, then you're going to have to either just stick to the PC speaker, well, for the sound effects part, or get an Adlib or Sound Blaster card for the music. This thing is capable of playing music, as you'll see in a bit, but usually not at the same time as the sound effects, just because of the way it works. Now, it can support multiple voices, but that's only done through a bit of trickery. I've never heard music and sound play simultaneously. I hear multiple sound effects play simultaneously, but that's in part to the game's mixing them at the same time. This can only support one voice through 8-bit audio, and at anywhere from like 8 kilohertz or something, all the way up to 44, if you really have a powerful CPU. Now, you might be wondering what actual hardware is inside the sound source. Well, it looks like this. I don't know if that tells you anything, but, you know, it's basically just some, like, glue logic and some transistors and some other things. It's all off-the-shelf components. You could clone this thing pretty easily, or at least you could with the Covox Speech Thing. Now, with the sound source, apparently it's got some different registers. The memory is written to it in a different way to access the sound, and I think there is also a little bit of rudimentary filtering going on from what I've read, so they're not directly compatible. I've seen sometimes where the Covox will work with Disney and vice versa, but most of the time it's not. Like, if it says sound source, it's probably just going to be sound source. But anyway, enough of that. We're going to go ahead and take a look at Duke Nukem 3D here, and this is one of those that you actually set it up manually to work with the sound source, as opposed to Wolf 3D and other things, which just detected automatically from the parallel port. And this is actually quite impressive. This is one of those that mixes everything all together and plays it through the sound source. Everything but the music, of course. Music, you'll need an ad-lib or something else to do that. But yeah, I'm just going to move it on over to a direct line-in input from the sound source so that you can hear the quality as it really is instead of a microphone next to the speaker. So yeah, just check this out.
Dang, those evil bastards are going to pay for shooting up my ride.
I love the idea of sounds and violence and phrases like that coming out of a little box with Mickey Mouse ears on it. It's just friggin' great to me. Like, it's made for these educational kind of children's games, and yeah, all of a sudden we've got, like, strippers and death. Wonderful. And lastly, we're gonna check out a mod tune in Mod Player, and yeah, you know, the reason I'm using Mod Player instead of something like Inertia is because that actually does not support the Disney sound source. It supports the Covox Speech Thing, once again, just because you had to program it differently in order to access the thing. But that's that. Let's go ahead and take a listen. That's pretty much it for the Disney sound source. An odd little device, to be sure. I really like the thing. I mean, I think it's just frickin' weird and kind of useless in some ways, but you know, I really like it because of those features exactly. The fact that it uses its own weird little internally powered speaker that wastes battery life is really cool in a completely obtuse and obnoxious kind of way. And it really was, I guess, a pretty good alternative for people who just wanted sound, especially on their educational kids games from Disney, without paying an arm and a leg. Nope, just a finger or two. Now that's all for this Oddware video, but if you'd like some more, well, why not take a look at these? I've done other Oddware things, of course, in the Covox Speech Thing, the Worm Drive, the Bernoulli Box, and a crap ton others, and more are coming, so if you would like to subscribe to my channel, I've got a lot of odd things in the works, as well as retro games and some modern stuff, whatever else I want to talk about. And as always, thanks for watching. I wonder what you get when you plug the Covox Speech Thing into the Disney sound source.
Phenomenal cosmic power!